We are looking at chapter number 3, election and representation. Question answer on election and representation. Which of the following resembles most a direct democracy? So the answer is the decisions taken by Gram Sabha. See, all are the ideas, all are the way of direct democracy. That means when you want to have a TV in your family, election of a class monitor, choice of a candidate by a political party, decision taken by a Gram Sabha, opinion polls conducted by the media. But this is the closest decision taken by the Gram Sabha, because Gram Sabha is actually making decisions from for the community, and everyone is involved here. But opinion polls conducted by the media, this involves more people. But still, we'll go with this D. Which of the following tasks are not performed by election commission? Supervising the panchayat elections. This is not done by election commission of India. The Nagar Nigam election, the panchayat election, these are not the responsibility of the election commission of India. The state election commission, the state election or state election commissioner, he is responsible. This person and this office is responsible for these election. Sthaniya Nikai ke chunav, they are responsible, not the election commission of India. Which of the following is common to the method of election of the members of Rajya Sabha and Lok Sabha? So the answer is that every citizen above the age of 18 is eligible for vote. So we have the universal, the voter franchise, universal adult franchise, which is the minimum age is 18 and above. In the first past the post system, that candidate is declared winner who has more votes than any other candidate in the constituency. Even if he is having one vote more than the other one, he is going to win. What is the difference between the system of reservation of constituency and the system of separate electorate? Why did the constitution makers reject the latter? Latter means separate electorate. So there is a difference between these two. Separate electorate system, it has been a curse of India because the British started this method in order to divide the Sikhs, the Muslims, the Hindus and the minorities. So these groups elect their own representative by separate vote. That means if there is a constituency and this constituency, say it is divided into Hindu, Muslim, Sikhs, others. Now the candidate who is going to be elected, if he is Hindu, only Hindu can vote. If he is Sikh, only Sikh can vote. Only Muslim can vote to a Muslim candidate. So this was a separate electorate system. But let me tell you more about this. These group elects their own representative by separate vote. And in a separate electorate system, the candidates are elected by those voters who belong to that particular community. Only Hindu can vote for the Hindu candidate. A Muslim cannot vote for a Hindu candidate. But what we have here is system of reservation of constituencies. All voters are eligible to vote. Everyone, first of all. Then candidate must belong to a particular community for which seat is reserved. For example, if this is a constituency and say SC is around 75% people, SC are living here. Another say 25% are Muslims, Hindu, the Sikhs, the Jains, etc. Now since this constituency is having a major chunk of scheduled caste population, so if a scheduled caste person is going to represent it, it will be better. That is why this particular constituency is reserved for the SC candidate. So candidates must belong to a particular community for which the seat is reserved here, and the constitution provides the reservation of seats in Lok Sabha and the state legislative assembly. That is, in Lok Sabha and the Vidhan Sabha, we have the reservation of seats. according to the population of SCSTs in India. So the constitution maker, they reject this one separate electorate system, because they were aware that the system of separate electorate destroyed the spirit of national integration. Now here, if only SC can be elected from here, but there may be many SC candidate who are standing, who are contesting for the election, but they will be voted by anyone, any caste creed. SC will also vote for them, Muslim will also vote for them, Hindu will also vote for them, Sikh will also vote for them, like this. Which of the following statements are incorrect? Identify and correct them by substituting, adding or rearranging only one word or phrase. So the answer from first is, FPTP system is followed for all election in India, and this is incorrect. Why? Because for Vidhan Sabha and Lok Sabha, for Vidhan Sabha and Lok Sabha, FPTP system is followed, but for the election of the President of India, Vice President of India, the Raj Sabha member, that is the upper house of the parliament, and the Vidhan Parishad, all the people, all the candidate who are elected, they are based on the other system, which is the PR system, variant of PR system, proportionate representation. Election Commission does not supervise panchayat and municipal elections. Yeah, this is correct. They are not involved here. The local body, state election commission is involved here. Election Commission is responsible for these, all these elections, this one, all these. President of India cannot remove an election commission. This is wrong. Only President of India can remove the election commissioner. Appointment of more than one election commissioner in the election commission is mandatory. This is incorrect, because before 1989, there was an election in 1993. So before 1989, there was only one election commissioner. Then just before this election, the two more are added. After this election, again two were disappointed, means only one was there, and from after that, three are there. One chief election commissioner and two are election commissioner, but it is not mandatory. So it was one earlier, now there are three. So it can, the government or the constitution may be amended to make them one or three or four or whatever number they want. Indian electoral systems aims at ensuring representation of social disadvantaged sections. However, we are yet to even this 10% women members in our legislatures. We are not having more than 10% ever. What measure would you suggest to improve this situation? Now, first of all, the Indian constitution provides the reservation for the SCs, the STs in our legislatives. That is the Lok Sabha, that is the Rajya's, this Vidhan Sabha, there is a reservation of seats, but it lacks the similar reservation for the marginalized class, as there should be more reservation for women through the constitutional amendment, which should not only be a proposal but also to be passed. So we are having 50% population, almost 50% population of the country as women. So this, we at least need 1/3 seats to be reserved for women. I'll just give you an example. In 2019 general elections, that is the Lok Sabha elections, TMC, Trinamool Congress, and Biju Janata Dal. Now these parties, they have given tickets to 1/3 candidates women. 1/3 candidates women. So they pave a path. They have given us the direction that when these party, and this is a national party, when they can give 1/3 seats, that means the candidate tickets to the candidate, why can't we have 1/3 representation of women when they are 50% in population? Okay, but let me tell you, this bill of 1/3 population, that is around 33% population, 33% reservation of women candidate, women seats, in these different legislatives. This bill is already there with the, it is pending in the parliament, but I don't know why it is not being passed. Here are some wishes expressed in conference to discuss constitution of a new country. Right against each of these, whether FPTP or proportional representation system is more suited to meet each of these wishes. The first is, people should clearly know who is their representative so that they can hold him or her personally accountable. The answer is FPTP, because in FPTP, the one member will be elected from one constituency of one party. So if he is not working, then the people can come to their task, they can ask the question. If he is working, they may again re-elect him, because in proportional system, one constituency may have different people, like in the proportion. So no one is actually can be held accountable. Next is, we have small linguistic minorities who are spread all over the country. We should ensure fair representation of them. For example, in India, we have 2% around Sikhs and 14% Muslims. But you will never find in 100 two Sikhs. You will never find in 100 14 Muslims. You will not find them. So if you want to represent them, because they are the actual population of the country, then we need to give proportional representation to them. Next is, there should be no discrepancy between votes and the seats for different parties. Again, proportional representation. How many or how much proportion of vote do you get? You are elected. That means if three people are there, he gets vote of say 40%, he gets 30%, he gets 30%. So 40% will be elected in the FPTP. These two people will not be elected. The problem is that they have got vote 60%, which is way more than this one. And these vote gets wasted in FPTP. So it should be proportional representation. People should be able to elect good candidate even if they do not like his or her political party. Again, FPTP. Sometimes a very good candidate is not given ticket, but he can be elected. He can come in the election as an independent member, independent candidate, and he may be elected, because the people, even if they don't like the party, whatever, but they are interested in him. They want him to be a leader, because he is working well for their constituency. A former chief election commissioner joined a political party. We are talking about TN Session example. TN Session. Now, he contested elections. There are various views on this issue. One view is that a former election commissioner is an independent citizen. Same goes with the Chief Justice of India, and has a right to join any political party and to contest election. According to the other view, leaving this possibility open can affect the impartiality of the election commission, because it is independent, it is impartial, it has to be impartial. So former election commissioner must not be allowed to contest any election. Which position do you agree with and why? So election commission of India is a constitutional independent body set for conducting free and fair election of the Union Parliament, the State Legislative Assembly, the President, Vice President, under the Article 324(1) of Indian Constitution. Now, this Election Commission is an impartial agency in order to conduct the free and fair elections in the country. Therefore, the Election Commissioner must not be allowed to contest any election, because it can affect the impartiality of the Commission. Now, I'll give an example. There is a member, there is an election commissioner. Now, there is a party 1, there is a party 2. Party 1 is very powerful, lot of money. Now, what he did when he was about to retire, when he is about to retire, he did so many things in the favor of party 1. He did not do, or he suppressed party 2 members, and he did everything against them. Why he did before superannuation, that is retirement, because the party P1 might have promised him that when you come out of means, once you retire, we'll give you a Rajya Sabha nomination. or you can contest the election with our flag, our symbol. So now this person or this member of this institution who is supposed to be impartial, who is supposed to be independent, who is supposed to work impartial of any of the party, now he is biased. So what in our agreement, even if they want to you know, do this, there should be a cooling off period, at least 3 year or 2 year period before they can join any party or get some Raj Sabha ticket or etc. like that. Indian democracy is now ready to shift from a crude first past the post system to a system of proportional representation. Do you agree with this statement? Give your reasons for or against this statement. So we need to agree with this statement because now India enjoys a multi-party system including the regional parties, and some places the regional parties are even stronger. Therefore, to provide the shape to all the political party, the proportional system is far better. Decentralization of power strengthens the sense of responsibility along with national unity and integrity. I'll just give you an example. In 2014 and 2019, BJP won the general elections. Now, BJP won the general election. Here they got around 30+% vote, they got around 35% plus vote. But if you see that 70% people are against them, and here 65% people are against them, but still this party is ruling everyone. So now we need that even the other parties like the Congress party, CPIM or the Biju Janata Dal, or you can say the Samajwadi party, all those have good vote shares. They should also have a proper representation in the legislature, which is not. So representation democracy makes the democracy more effective and trustworthy, because all the caste, creed, religion, every faction of the society is properly represented. It ensures the political parties to get seats along with the proportional votes. So even if a party has got 10% of the vote, they don't have a single MP, they don't have a single Vidhayak. This is indiscrepancy, and this should not be allowed, because 10 out of 100 people, they want this party, but this party has no member at all to make the rules, regulation and the kanun for these people, 10% people. And the Election Commission has allowed the voters to change governors peacefully, both at the state and the national level. See, when this government comes, they can do whatever they want. That is, they will guide the president, they will have the election commissioner, they will have the chief justice, they will have the governors of different state. So now when the other parties which have all got the share of votes, if they are involved, the party, any party which is there in the power, they cannot do whatever they want. So there is a check and balance, and voters have consistently keen interest to the election process. Therefore, the number of candidates and parties are continuously on rise. Now, previously it was being thought that the PR system is quite tough. Mathematically, it's not being understood by everyone. That is why people are not having interest in political science or politics even. Now everyone is almost, you know, literate. Even if he is illiterate, he is aware that what to do, how to vote. So now this proportional system is far better than the FPTP system. Now we are going to see some additional questions, and this we are going to take in the next discussion. Till then, thank you so much and take care of yourself.